And now to our presentation. We are pleased to have two presenters joining us for today's topic. Our first presenter is Dr. Ferry Kienberger. Dr. Kienberger has been with Agilent Laboratories in Austria since 2007. He has a PhD degree in technical physics, and his current focus is on nanoscale imaging, including microwave network analysis for semiconductor devices, materials science, and life science applications. Our second presenter is Dr. Johannes Hoffmann. Dr. Hoffmann received his PhD degree in electrical engineering from the Swiss Institute of Technology. He currently works for METAS, focusing on numerical electromagnetic field simulation, scanning microwave microscopes, and microwave systems in general. And it looks like we're ready to begin. It gives me great pleasure to welcome our first presenter, Dr. Ferry Kienberger. You may begin, Ferry.
Thank you, Joan, for the introduction. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Ferry Kienberger. I am a member of the Agilent Labs team in Austria. The Agilent Labs is the central corporate research lab headquartered in Santa Clara in US and has many labs also in Europe and in Asia. The goal of the Agilent Labs is to find new applications and to develop new technologies for the long term, particularly, and focus to scientific and research exploitation. In the following, I will give the state of the art of our Agilent scanning microwave microscope that was introduced by Agilent a few years ago. In particular, I will cover three topics, which is the first one, complex impedance measurement. The second one will be dopant density measurements. And the third one is modeling and comparison with experiments. The agenda you see now on the second slide is to give you basics of the SMM, introduction on atomic force microscope and also scanning microwave microscope, which is SMM. Then the complex impedance, particularly useful for material science. The dopant profiling, which is a differential capacitance DCDV, particularly useful for semiconductors. And the modeling will deal with three-dimensional electromagnetic modeling using the Agilent software EMPro. And finally, I will make a summary and conclude and outlook of this technology. So first, let me tell you how does an AFM work. Imagine you sit on a breakfast table and you close your eyes and you move with your finger over the table. And you do this in a raster scanning mode. So line by line, you move over the table and you will notify different properties of the table. First, you might notify high and round structures. You may differentiate between hard and soft structures. Some is warm, some is cold. Electrical charges, hopefully you will not recognize because it's too dangerous. And with this sensation, you can then make an image in your mind of the surface of the breakfast table as well as the properties. So this is what the AFM does, moving a small needle over the sample surface and make a 3D topographical image as well as materials properties from the sample. It's important to note that standard AFM imaging can only measure the surface topography and not materials properties inside the material, inside the sample. But with SMM, you might see that we can also move further on this. Here you see now standard images, topographical images acquired with an AFM. On the left-hand side, you see two bright spots, which are two cells imaged in a living cell status, meaning in liquid and buffered solution in dynamic force mode AFM. And what the image tells you is in XY, it gives you the scale of the sample here in that case, it's roughly 100 micrometer times 100 micrometer, and the color gives you the height of the sample. So bright colors mean the object is high, and dark colors mean the object is low. Typically, the height ranges between a nanometer to, let's say, 10 micrometer overall. On the right-hand side, you see a cell image acquired on the cytoskeleton part of the cell. So this is a zoom in. So on the right-hand side, the image only has roughly 10 times 10 micrometer and shows you finer features of the cell surface structure. All is standard EFM images in topography. Below sketch shows how it is arranged. So you have a small cantilever that scans over a sample surface with the small circles, which are supposed to be DNA molecules. And in dynamic force mode, as in opposite to contact mode, you have an oscillating tip via magnetic excitation. But different modes are available, like contact mode and magnetic oscillation mode, for instance. We have several AFMs that we can use for this scanning microwave microscope, and here you see an overview of our Agilent product modularity. It ranges from simple AFMs to more complex AFMs. For instance, the large stage AFM in the lower row, in the center roughly, is a heavyweight AFM, which has very low damping, and therefore the mechanical noise is low, and you get very good resolution topographical images. On the upper right, you see the SMM sketched, which shows a 54, a simple AFM with a network analyzer, which I come later to more details. What is an SMM? An SMM is a combination of an AFM plus a network analyzer, a PNA, which stands for Performance Network Analyzer, because it measures the network analysis properties at high frequencies. And similar name is VNA, which is Vector Network Analyzer. So the combination of both with a certain interface, which is the nose cone, gives you the SMM, and you connect the AFM with the PNA with a simple coax cable. The PNA typically works at different frequencies. Standard PNAs work between 1 and 20 gigahertz. So also the SMM can measure between 1 and 20 gigahertz typically, and it generates a microwave signal and it measures it. This is what the PNA does. You see more details on the working principle of an SMM. On the upper left, you see the 56 large stage AFM where a full wafer from semiconductor fits into the sample holder, and you can move the scanner very accurately over the full wafer. In the lower left is the network analyzer used here, and the upper right shows you the mechanical connection between the AFM and the coax cable. In particular, we use for SMM a conductive tip and a properly made mechanically engineered RF connection. And in the SMM sketch, you see that the PNA signal is coming from the PNA. So the PNA generates the microwave signal, moves all the way down via the coaxial resonator to the very end of the AFM tip. Then the electromagnetic field interacts with the material under the tip. Part of it is reflected, part of it is transmitted. The reflected signal goes all the way down on the same cables, on the same hardware, back to the PNA, and the PNA measures the reflection coefficient S11, called scattering parameter 111. The scattering 11 parameter is measured by the PNA, and this is what is the original signal in the SMM. The EFM cantilever deflection is measured by the standard laser beam deflection and operated typically in contact mode AFM. The next topic is what can we do with this SMM? And the first part is the complex impedance for material science application. So you have here a sketch of the SMM tip, which is a conductive AFM tip. And it moves on the material A, and then it goes to the material B. And when you acquire the frequency response curve with the SMM, you acquire the S11 magnitude, so the amplitude in this case, via the frequency. And you see various notches, typically every 2 gigahertz, that comes from the cable. So the cable length typically defines the resonance notches. Each resonance notch can be used for a very sensitive measurement. Once you move from the region A to the region B, the resonance curve changes because the material properties changes from A to B, and the notches shift both in XY but also in depth. And this shift typically is in the range of megahertz, and this is measured also in the PDA SMM. In particular, the materials properties we investigate here are the permittivity, in particular the complex permittivity, which is the real part epsilon prime and the imaginary part epsilon double prime, as well as permeability, so magnetic properties, and for semiconductor materials, important the conductivity and also the dopant density or carrier concentration. Here you see how the capacitance calibration works. So the first application of SMM is to measure calibrated capacitance. We have a reference sample in the lower left, where you see the topographical image of the reference sample. The small circular shaped pads are of gold, and there are small capacitors. We use those small capacitors to calibrate the capacitance by using a simple parallel plate capacitor formula, which is given here and say C is equal to E, which is the dielectric constant of the oxide, which is below the gold pad, times A, which is the area of the gold pad, of the circular arrangement of gold pads, and D is the thickness of the oxide. So the gold pads are residing on different thicknesses of oxide, and this is on the semiconductor. So they form small capacitors. On the upper left image, you see the resulting final S11 amplitude image in dB. So the different colors give you different reflection coefficients, S11, and after calibration, you can transfer them into capacitance values in femtofarad. And this calibration is quite linear. As you see, the plots, when you compare the S11 values versus the area of the gold pad, the larger the gold pad, the larger is the capacitance, the larger is the S11 signal. And also, the larger the oxide step, the smaller is the capacitance, and if you plot 1 over S11 in the lower right image, that goes linearly with the step height of the oxides in nanometer, which range from 50 nanometer to 200 nanometer, 220 nanometer. So this sample we use for calibration. And once you look now for the sensitivity, you receive the following. The upper left is a good electrical contact image between the electrical conductive cantilever and the gold pads. Once you have some dirt or dust from the air on the conductive material, like on the gold pads, shown in the upper right with the red arrow, you lose the electrical contact and you lose the signal. You don't see any capacitance anymore. And if you draw the smallest gold pads, you see that the noise level is around 1 arptofarad. So the gold pads, smallest one, have typically 150 arptofarad in signal, and the noise in between in the cross section is roughly 1 arptofarad. So this is the current noise level typically we have, and it's good because, for instance, small varactors in semiconductor industries for high frequencies in the gigahertz range that you have in your cell phones, they typically are so small, 10 arptofarad roughly in variable capacitances. So you need a resolution or sensitivity of roughly 1 arptofarad to properly resolve them. And this is what we achieve with the high sensitive network analyzer that we use here for SMM. A second application after capacitance is capacitance spectroscopy. So not only capacitance can be registered or measured, but also capacitance with respect to the tip bias. You change the DC tip bias typically from -5 volt to +5 volt, and you measure then how the capacitance is changing. And on the upper left, for instance, the N-type semiconductor is shown for two different dopant densities, ranging from here 10 to 15 atoms per cube centimeter in the red and blue curve to 10 to the 19 atoms per cube centimeter, so very high doped. And the lower the doping, the higher is the change in the capacitance in this curve for an N-type. And for the P-type in the lower right, the trend is different. So it starts with a high frequency and it reduces until you have a positive tip voltage. The reason for this change is based on standard semiconductor theory. So what it does is that the depletion zone in the semiconductor is influenced by the tip bias. It is either attracted or rejected from the surface, and depending on this, the capacitance increases or decreases. When you attract the depletion zone to the surface, the diameter gets smaller of the depletion zone, and therefore the capacitance then gets higher because it's inverse with the thickness. Those CV spectroscopy measurements can be used to study the semiconductor properties, but also additional properties of the interface, trap density, oxide thickness, and hysteresis and memory effects can be studied. There's one publication given here, and I cite the publications of this work we've done in the last years in the bottom of the slide. We can also do complex impedance imaging, so it's not only capacitance can be measured, but also resistance. I just briefly mentioned this because Johannes, the second presenter for METAS in Switzerland, will focus on the complex impedance imaging and the corresponding analysis. in short, what it does, we use the PME amplitude and phase image, and we can calculate out of the PME capacitance and phase image using the simple S11 formula, which is a standard reference formula used in the microwave field. We can use this to transfer the images to capacitance images and resistance images. You see here the sample, the capacitance calibration sample on the topography, on the lower left hand, you see the gold pads again. You see also dust and dirt attached to the gold pads. If you look to those dust and dirt with arrows, red arrows, you see that those dust doesn't have a capacitance signal because it's an insulator and it destroys the electrical contact. But you see, on the other hand, that you see that you can measure the resistance of those dirt and dust in these red spots. All those red spots in the resistance image have a high resistance of 0 to 10K, typically 5K ohms, which is much higher of resistance than, for instance, the gold pads, which are conductive and have almost zero resistance. But this was published last year from Johannes in papers, and Johannes will focus on this in the next presentation. The next topic I want to show you what the SMM can be used for is dopant profiling for semiconductors. What we have here is a cross-sectional sample with differently doped densities ranging from 10 to 16 to 10 to 20 atoms per cube centimeter supplied by IMEC in Belgium. The topography of this is flat. That's left image, it's flat, but it's intentional flat. We don't have to have structures in the topography. But if you scan with the SMM and you measure the differential amplitude, DCDV, which is the change of the capacitance by changing the voltage, you see that the differently doped areas have different signal responses. And the stripes are those stripes that are differently doped. So we can measure those doping densities in a wide range as given before. Once it is calibrated with this calibration sample that I showed you, we can transfer the DCDV values into dopant density values shown on an SRAM memory sample. Here, the topography is in the upper left. You see differently doped channels. I don't go into details here. The topography doesn't tell you so much except different heights of the different channels. If you look to the simultaneously acquired DCDV image on the upper right, you see different colors, and the different colors gives you the different signals of and corresponding dopant densities. And you can differentiate first between positively doped and negatively doped, so p-type and n-type semiconductors. And second, you can also differentiate between different doping densities. And the table in the lower left compares the SMM dopant densities with the reference values given by the manufacturer and macroscopic methods. And it fits quite nicely together, particularly relative accuracy. Within one image, you can differentiate roughly by 20% accuracy, which is also a rough value for the capacitance error. We get typically 20%, and also here for relative dopant density profiling. One example here, if you zoom in further, you see the SRAM sample again in the topography upper left with not too much information, but the corresponding dopant density image shows something interesting, which is relevant for the semiconductor industry, and which is that you have differently doped channels. For instance, all the bright stuff in the topography should be homogeneously doped and should be white in the dopant density image. But you see occasionally, like in the blue arrow, that there are small channels in the larger channel that are defect structures. And those defect structures are, for instance, here red, which are differently doped than the channel itself. And this defect structure now reduces the performance of this device, and also in the channel below, like given here, there's another defect structure, and you can localize those defect structures, and which are not, of course, visible in the topography because you see only the upper part of the image. So that you see only the upper part of the sample in AFM topography, and with the dopant density SMM, you can measure inside the sample quite some distance. And also the PN transition region can be mapped with this with a good resolution. The last chapter is on the modeling. I want to show you that EM Pro, which is the 3D modeling software suite from Agilent, typically used in the semiconductor industry, do model different kind of materials. Generally use EDS for a 2D circuit circuit modeling, like you have electronic cables and so on. And EMPro you use typically for measuring 3D structures. So you import the commutated CAD file from mechanics, you import into EMPro, and it calculates automatically by FEM, so finite element modeling, the electromagnetic field distribution of the sample, which gives you insights into the field in the materials. What it is used for typically is to model your cell phone when you talk and you have the cell phone close to your brain. You want to know how much electromagnetic interaction with your brain happens. It should not be too much, instead it warms up. Or in radar applications, the radar antenna's transmission is modeled on an airplane. The airplane should not influence the radar distribution too much. Or in high-speed interconnectors, what you have now currently in your telecommunication stuff, which works typically also in the gigahertz frequency. We use this EMPro for modeling the SMM and the small nanoscale interactions. In the upper left, you see how the meshing of the EMPro looks like. So the cantilever is meshed on a small metal plate, and we can study the electromagnetic field distribution first, and second also the complex impedance values. So we measure the complex impedance value with the SMM, and we model it with the EMPro. You just have to import the geometry of your sample, the cantilever, into EMPro, and then you press the button and you get the complex impedance around the tip, like shown here for differently thick oxides of 10 nanometer oxide, 20 nanometer oxide, and 50 nanometer oxide. And the question is whether the field can penetrate those 50 nanometer oxide or 20 or 10. And the modeling gives exact information on, for instance, how much thickness you can penetrate with your electromagnetic fields. So this is included in the EMPro 2012 version and is also recently published in an Agilent app note shown here. So the EMPro looks like on the lower left, on the middle left, which is panel on the field distribution and the cantilever. And the right gives you some examples where we compare the SMM measurements on the left column, and the EMPro modeling is on the right column. We use the cross structure supported by MPE, Max Planck Institute in Germany, in Mainz. We included the cross structure into EMPro in the right picture. And we modeled the different fields on the metal and on the oxide bar. And the modeling indeed very nicely coincidences with the measurements. We saw the complex impedance measurement of the SMM reasonably agreeing at 100 k-ohm given here with the modeling, and also the spatial resolution could be repeated in both modeling and experiment. So I close here with a summary. The features are indeed that we can measure impedance data as well as complex permittivity, which means the dielectric constant and the loss factor. For semiconductors, both silicon and compound semiconductors can be measured in a large dynamic range. All is in one scan, so you get simultaneously the topo, the dopant, and the impedance. It is at a high spatial resolution, only governed by the tip diameter, typically 10 nanometer. And you have broadband frequencies. You can measure between 1 and 20 gigahertz. That's unique also when you compare it with, for instance, tone-built resonators and cavity resonators that work only at one frequency. Here you can work and select the frequency depending on your needs and your sample and the frequency range you want to investigate. So we have shown you how to measure topography and impedance. We have shown you how to measure the device capacitance and dopant concentration and profiling. With the complex impedance, you can also calculate the permittivity, the real part and the imaginary part of the permittivity, dielectric constant. In future, other things might be possible as well, which are not yet possible, which is, for instance, magnetic measurements or S21 transmission imaging or biomeasurements. So it's not yet possible, but we are working on it with research collaborations in Europe. And what we want to do is, of course, also bio-SMM, applying the electromagnetic fields to proteins, to ion channels, and to measure the properties of single molecules. So that's catched here, but it's not a real measurement. A session in the annual Linz Winter Workshop, that is every February in Linz, focuses this time on SMM and application to cells and biomeasurements. So if you're interested, you can join this. And finally, I want to thank for your attention, and you have my contact email, or you can contact Agilent also in general. So thanks for your attention, and I will give back to Joan.
necessary. Johannes, I just want to check to make sure that you are connected to the event.
Johannes, you have to press star then 6 to unmute yourself.
There, Johannes.
All right, let me try to Johannes, let me try to unmute your line. One moment, please. Johannes, your line is open. You should be able to speak.
Okay. So, do you hear me now?
Yes, we do.
Okay, so I start. Okay, I'm just giving this presentation from my desktop, so that's the reason why the image has changed a bit on your desktop. My name is Johannes Hoffmann, as already said, and here you see in the list of authors, you see my colleagues, Michael Wolonsack and Markus Zeyer. Then there is as well Jens Niegemann from ETHZ, who contributed to this work, Hans-Peter Huber. Was already mentioned in Ferry's talk, and Ferry Kienberger. So the talk is about a calibration algorithm for near-field scanning microwave microscopes.
Dr. Hoffmann, I apologize for interrupting, but we are not seeing your computer screen or your desktop at this moment.
Oh, okay. Was my fault, sorry.
That's okay.
Okay, now it should be okay, I guess.
And you may want to expand your screen for a moment so we can
like
see
this.
That looks perfect. Thank you so much.
Okay, sorry for that.
That's okay.
So, you just missed the first slide. The title slide looks like this. I guess you heard what I said about it. So now we come to the outline of the talk. First, I give a short introduction on what is an SMM, how it works. This is very similar to what Ferry said. Then I give a short literature survey about what are the techniques for calibrating an SMM. And then I will present our technique, the linear network approach. And finally, I will give some results of this approach. Okay. So this is very general. We call often these scanning microwave microscopes as well near-field scanning microwave microscopes, so it's very much the same thing. They're applied in semiconductor manufacturing, solar cell manufacturing, as well for fuel cell membranes, so if you want to characterize these membranes, and experimentally as well in biology. And what can you do with such a scanning microwave microscope? You can measure permittivity on the nanoscale. This means you can measure the permittivity of a cube of approximately 100 nanometers times 100 nanometer times 100 nanometer. Or you can measure miniature lumped elements. So this means resistors, capacitances, and inductances. Miniature means here something like micrometers or several hundred nanometers. Okay, so this is what you can see now is a sketch of a schematic representation of a SMM. You have this laser here, which is shining on the back of a cantilever. The laser beam is reflected to a photosensor, which detects this laser beam. And depending on how strong the cantilever is bent, the laser beam moves up here in the photosensor and gives different results. So this setup allows us to approach the sample in a way that the cantilever is always bent in the same way or in the same strength, which allows us to control finally the force between tip and sample. So once the cantilever is in position, we send from the vector network analyzer a high frequency signal through the cable and through the impedance matching network along the cantilever down to the tip. At the tip, this electromagnetic wave interacts with the sample and is reflected back through the cantilever impedance matching network and cable and then detected in the VNA. This detection gives us basically a ratio between sent out wave and received wave. Now we can record this value, but what we are interested in is what is below the tip of the cantilever, what kind of material is this? And we need to make a link between what is this material and what does the vector network analyzer measure at this position. And about how to make this link will be the rest of this talk. So obviously there have been already, in earlier times, there have been researchers who tried to make this link. One quite famous researcher is Gao in this field. What he used is, or what he did is he put the tip on the sample and then retracted it slowly and recorded the reflection at each height level. So what you can see then, or what a result of this technique would be this, these resonances, which shift in frequency and as well in width. So the resonance width corresponds to the losses in the sample, and the resonance shift in frequency corresponds to the permittivity of the sample. There are a few advantages of this technique. It can be very accurately, or it can be very accurate, and it's a very easy experiment because it can be done very fast for one point, and so this means there are low stability requirements. But there's as well a few disadvantages. For example, it's very time consuming if you want to do this for a whole image, which consists of several thousand points. So there it's maybe not that practical. Then the second problem is specific to more complicated instruments like this Agilent SMM, where you have several resonance frequencies and they're in between as well frequencies where you're not sure if it's a resonance frequency or not. And then we tried out this theory with this instrument and we saw that it's not really applicable to this kind of instrument. So we looked further. Then there's Hans-Peter Huber, which was already mentioned by Ferry Kienberger. He developed a technique where he uses two or more known standards to calibrate the SMM, and then he interpolates between these results to measure intermediate values. A graphical representation is given above. You, for example, you just measure a sample which gives you the red upper value and the blue lower value, and you can just interpolate in between, and you can, for example, interpolate for permittivity of the dielectric or conductivity or dopant density. So it's very versatile, this method. Advantages are it's very simple because it's only interpolation. It allows fast scanning because you have to measure only at one frequency and you can be always in contact with the sample. And as already said, it's very versatile. It's applicable to capacitance, dopant density, resistivity. But it has a disadvantage. One disadvantage it has is that it gives erroneous results, or at least results with unknown error, if you're not making an interpolation but an extrapolation, meaning that your measured value is outside of the range in which you calibrated. And the method cannot discriminate between loss mechanism and capacitive mechanism. Okay, so now I jump to the technique we proposed. This is looking at the SMM as a linear network. So you see in this flow chart above, you see the wave A and B. So A corresponds to the wave which is sent out by the vector network analyzer, and B is the wave which is received by the vector network analyzer. So when you send out a wave from the vector network analyzer, there will be reflection obstacles in the cable and the impedance matching network. And so there's some part of the wave which will never reach the tip. It's already reflected before back to the VNA. So this is captured by E00. Then, for the moment being, we assume that all the energy of the wave which is sent out reaches the tip, and then there it is reflected with the reflection factor G as a sample, and then it's transmitted back from the tip to the VNA via the term E01. So E01 will capture all losses and time delays which occur on the travel from the VNA to the tip and from the tip back to the VNA. And finally, there's this term E11, which describes what happens to some reflected energy from the sample. So this reflected energy is traveling towards the VNA, but maybe it encounters an obstacle and is reflected back to the tip. And this kind of behavior is captured by E11. And below, you see how this can be put into formulas, this flow chart. S11 is the reflection coefficient. It corresponds to wave B divided by wave A. And the formula you can read behind that. Maybe a word about this G. It's a reflection which is due to what's below the tip. And this is the set tip. It's an impedance of which is below the tip, minus a reference impedance, which is which you can choose arbitrarily in this case. Okay, so now the question is, how can we get to this E00 and E01 and E11? Because if we would know these three complex factors, we can deduce from S11, we can calculate backwards and get a G, and from G we can get set tip. And this is what we wanted to have finally. So how can we get E00, E01, E11? This is done by calibration, and for this purpose we measure three known impedances. So this means three known set tip. When we have done that, we write down the measurement equation. This was the equation I presented before, the lower one, three times. And this gives us a system of equations, and we can solve this system for E00, E01, and E11. Okay, so maybe you may ask now, how can we know set tip of something? So for that reason, we have a calibration substrate. It's again the same substrate you have seen already in Ferry's presentation. It consists of a wafer, which is of p-doped silicon. On this wafer, there are silicon oxide steps grown with 50 nanometer height. So here the rightmost step is 50 nanometer, then approximately 100 nanometer, 150 nanometer, 200 nanometer. On these steps, there are gold dots with varying diameter. The diameter varies from 1 micrometer to 5 micrometer. Okay. So if we look at the semiconductor physics, what is happening in such a gold dot, on the left-hand side, you see the charges which accumulate in the metal, so in the gold. Then you have this dielectric, the silicon oxide. And then below the silicon oxide, you have this depletion charge, which is this one. And if you are in the DC case, you would have this accumulation charge here. But as we're in a high-frequency case, this charge doesn't apply. It's only here because I copied the figure from a textbook. Below, you find the formulas or the equations for these two capacitances. The Cox is the capacitance in the oxide. The Cdep, it's depletion capacitance, it's this one. And the complete capacitance the SMM will sense is a serious connection of these two capacitances. Okay, that's the way we can get this set tip. So, but unluckily, we are not completely sure about the input parameters to the formulas for Cox and Cdep. This is because they are fringing capacitances. So we assume here that they're approximately 30% of the nominal value of the capacitance we assume for calibration. They are assumed as an uncorrelated uncertainty input. And then depletion capacitance is about 10% of the nominal value, the error, and it's correlated. So maybe a word why this depletion capacitance error is correlated. So imagine, for example, for depletion capacitance, the temperature of the semiconductor is important. So if we are not calculating with the right temperature, this will be the same error for all capacitances on the substrate. So this is the reason why this error is correlated. Fringing capacitance is dependent on the shape of the gold dot and the size of the gold dot. So it's different for all capacitances on the substrate. So that's the reason why it's uncorrelated. There are some neglected uncertainties in this calculation. These are the uncertainties of the VNA, like drift, noise, and linearity, and the uncertainty of the model of the tip-sample interaction. So maybe the second is the most important in this calculation. Okay, how do we propagate the uncertainties? For this, we use Meta's Unslip. Meta's Unslip is a library which allows you to calculate with uncertainty. So all you have to do is you have to specify your input quantities with distribution and correlation. You have to specify a measurement model, and then Meta's Unslip calculates for you the output quantities and their uncertainties and correlations. I don't say more about this. That's the basic principle of Meta's Unslip. And we applied all this to this sample with the gold dots and the silicon oxide steps and calculated the capacitance, what you can see here. So for the lowest step, which is 50 nanometers, you see we have a quite high capacitance. Going up gives us lower capacitance, and staying on the same step below here, it's barely visible. You have a very small gold dot, it has nearly no capacitance. Smaller ones have smaller capacitance. So this is already a reasonable result. Then we measured as well the resistance. Here you can see, as Ferry already explained, here's some kind of small dirt, which gives a higher resistance. Here you have a piece of dirt which was dragged with the tip of the AFM, so this gives this kind of line behavior. And if you have a look at the resistance scale, you see here minus 1,000 ohm. So this looks very unphysical because you have not a negative resistance on your substrate, but you will see soon that this is just due to the measurement tolerances or the uncertainties in this process. Okay, so here is the uncertainty of the capacitance. You can see that the uncertainty of the capacitance is largest for the larger capacitances and small for the smaller capacitances. This is because the uncertainty is proportional to the size of the capacitance as given by the fringing capacitance influence. And yeah, this is visible throughout the whole picture. So now we go to the uncertainty of the resistance. So you see, for example, here where we had this negative resistance, we have now an uncertainty of more than 1,000 ohm. So this means by the uncertainty, the fact that we measured a negative resistance is still covered, so we can come to 0 ohm if we add uncertainty and value. What's maybe important to note is that you get the lowest uncertainty, which is around 1 ohm, on the biggest capacitance. This is because here you can measure very well because the capacitance gives a relatively small impedance, and so you can detect small changes in the impedance in these areas. Whereas where you have very small capacitance, you have already large impedance from the capacitance influence, so it's very difficult to measure very small changes of resistance in these areas where you have small capacitance. Okay, so just for checking the values, these were only pictures. So this calibration was done on the following gold dots, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 6. So this means, we go maybe to this is 1, 1. This is the second row, third, fifth, this one, the fifth in the second row, this is this calibration. And 6, 6 is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. One moment. 5, 6. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 3, 4, 5, 6. So this is this one. This is the third gold dot which was used for calibration. And now we are looking at the verification dot, which is 2.6. So this is second row, sixth gold dot, this one. We look at this one to verify our calibration. And if you measure it, you have 7 femtofarads plus minus 1.9 femtofarad from the aforementioned uncertainty contributors. And if you calculate its capacitance from just from the surface of this gold dot, it's 8.4 femtofarads, so you see that measurement and theory agree very well. If you look at its resistance, it says here in the measurement 37.6 ohm plus minus 21.1 ohm, but in theory there shouldn't be any resistance, so it's zero. So you see that there's a small mismatch because you cannot come to zero ohm with this uncertainty, and I think this disagreement comes from the fact that we did not take into account the sample or tip sample interaction completely. There are still some contact resistances included which are, or there's some contact resistances which are not included in our model but which are there in reality. And this is the reason for this, this discrepancy. Okay, so now let me come to the conclusion. This new algorithm I presented distinguishes between loss mechanism and capacitance mechanism. It enables fast scanning because it needs only one frequency and it stays always in contact mode. And this is valid for all kind of measurement results. So if you have resistive and capacitive on the same sample, you can measure this with this technique. Okay. That's all. Thank you. Now I'm handing back to Joan.
And we would like to thank you, Dr. Hoffman and Dr. Kienberger, for a very informative presentation. I'm going to go ahead and move the audience back into the normal WebEx presentation mode. Before we go to the question and answer session, we ask that you complete a short polling survey concerning today's presentation. While the poll is optional, we appreciate you taking the time to answer each question. The poll is now open on the lower right side of your console, and we thank you for completing this survey. And while the audience is completing the polling survey, I just want to offer a reminder that following the seminar, you will be receiving an email that includes a recording link for today's presentation, as well as a PDF copy of the presentation. Thank you so much for completing the polling survey. We have a few more minutes left in today's event. So we'll now go to the question and answer portion concerning the presentation. You may ask questions at any time by putting them in the question box. We will answer them in order. To ask questions over the telephone line, press star and then one on your touchtone phone and the operator will open your line. If your question has already been answered or if you wish to remove yourself from the telephone queue, press the pound key. So Ferry and Johannes, if you're ready, I just want to make sure that your both your audios are working. So I just heard Johannes. Barry, are you there?
Yes, I'm here also.
Terrific. So the first question is what is the resolution of SMM?
Okay, what is the resolution on SMM is the question. The answer is the topographical resolution. The lateral resolution is given by the AFM tip diameter, so that's standard for AFM imaging. But I suppose you mean more the electrical resolution. So also the lateral resolution for the electrical images are similar to the mechanical resolution. Also, the electrical fields are a bit more spread on the AFM tip, but typically you get this 10 nanometer for dopant densities or even better. That's my answer with respect to resolution.
Thank you, Barry. Another question that's come in is, how do you select the resonance frequency for DC-DV measurements? And the comment is, some frequencies, such as 2.3 gigahertz, seem to yield better contrast than others.
Okay, maybe Johannes, I take this question and you take the next one with the tip diameter, because this is the field where also you did some research. On the frequency,
okay.
Yes, indeed. The higher the frequency, the better the measurement. So 20 gigahertz is better than 1 gigahertz, because complex impedance Z is equal to 1 over J omega C. Omega is the frequency and then C is the capacitance. At the given capacitance, the higher the frequency, the better the signal. So that's an advantage. But indeed, the quality of the individual notches every 2 gigahertz, for instance at 2.3, but also at 18 gigahertz or so, they are good notches, meaning the slope of this notch curve is very good, very high, and you have a good sensitivity. When you change the capacitance, the S11 amplitude is changed properly. This can have several reasons in the hardware of the cables, but also in the sample physics, like you have P or N-typed, or you have other structures in the sample that can change the mobility. So maybe that's a quick answer on the first one. So Johannes, maybe you can comment on the tip diameter.
Yes.
Yeah, and I'll ask if I can, does that deal with the second part of the question, Ferry?
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah, let me read that out first so the audience has the benefit of what that question is. And so, Johannes, this comes in two parts. It says, what is the impact of tip degradation to calibrate SMM measurements, and do calibrations change with the tip diameter?
Okay. So the impact of tip degradation is usually that the tip gets larger, and if you have a larger tip, you get a stronger contrast in the electrical signal. And if you have a calibrated SMM measurement, you will see as the tip degrades, you will see larger capacitances or larger changes in the signal. And if you do calibrated epsilon R measurements, you get larger epsilon R. And if you do calibrated dopant density, we'll get larger larger dopant density if the tip degrades. So I hope this is the answer.
Another question that's come in is, does SMM work only with resonant mode, or is non-resonant mode available also?
Maybe a quick answer on this. So it's a transmission line SMM and not the resonance cavity SMM. Now you have only one frequency. Here we have a bundle of frequencies in the broadband mode. We can measure at from 1 to 20 gigahertz, typically every 2 gigahertz, with a very good resolution. So in that way, it's a transmission line with different notches and different frequencies that can be used with this machine.
Another question that's come in is, what is the scan range and speed?
That's the standard EFM operation. Scan range typically is 100 times 100 micrometer in XY, and speed is standard EFM speed imaging, so typically one line per second, depending also on electrical parameters, but per image, then depending on the size of pixels, 2, 3 minutes, 4 minutes per image.
I do want to check with Perry just to see if anyone's holding on the phone line.
At this time, there are no questions in queue.
Thank you so much. Another question that's come in is, what's the maximum Z range that the SMM can measure on a sample? And I guess it's the expected sample roughness.
Yes, so maybe Johannes, the answer is also easy here, and it's 10 micrometer roughly.
Another question is, what is the typical measurement time for one scan?
The typical measurement time for one scan is using standard parameters and standard sample, it's 3 or 4 or 5 minutes per scan, which includes all the channels in dope intensity, in impedance and topography.
And another question that's come in is, how do you calibrate height measurements for topography purposes?
Johannes, I'll let this one to you.
Okay. You can use calibration samples which are where you have known height steps, and in this way you can adjust your AFM so that these calibration samples are measured and you look at the image and you change the gain in a fashion that the measured results are the same as the specified results, and then your AFM is height calibrated.
I just want to check with both presenters if you can check your chat area and also your Q&A panel to see if any questions have come to you privately. I believe we've captured all of them, but I want to double check.
No questions, Jim?
No, I think they're all answered up to now.
Okay, wonderful. So it does appear that there's no further questions, so please join me in thanking Dr. Ferry Kienberger and Dr. Johannes Hoffman for their presentations. I would like to call your attention to the slide currently displayed listing upcoming e-seminars. If these titles are of interest to you or your colleagues, please go to our website to register. On behalf of the Electronic Measurement Group at Agilent Technologies, we thank you for joining us today, and we hope to see you at a future e-seminar. We will leave the question box open for a few more minutes to receive any feedback or additional questions. Any additional questions that we receive, we will respond to following today's event. And we are now going to close the audio line. Thank you once again for attending. From Agilent Technologies, we wish you a good day.